Good morning. I'm joined today by our very good emergency director, management director, Mike Sprayberry. I'm Governor Pat McCrory. First, I want to thank the Charlotte Fire Department for having us here today so we can give the entire state of North Carolina the latest information regarding this temporary fuel shortage. Our primary focus remains ensuring that our first responders have the fuel and supplies that they need. And for consumers, I'm proud to announce that we have just received some good news. The Colonial Pipeline officials have notified us this morning that the construction and positioning of the bypass pipeline in Alabama is now complete. Colonial engineers are testing the pipeline today, and upon successful completion, will prepare for a safe restart of the main fuel line. They project the line will restart tomorrow. However, it will still take several days for the fuel delivery supply chain to return to normal. And I want to emphasize that. It will still take several days for the normal fuel supply chain to return to normal. Now, I want to give you a little background on this. On September 9th, Colonial Pipeline officials discovered a leak in the pipeline in Alabama, where an estimated 252,000 gallons were spilled. As a result, the pipeline, which is the primary source of gasoline for North Carolina and many states in the Southeast, especially in the further west part of the Southeast, was entirely shut down. The good news is that the fuel continues to flow into the state, but at a very reduced rate. As a result of the pipeline leak in Alabama, North Carolina is currently receiving about one-third of our normal supply of fuel. Now, while we are hearing of intermittent fuel outages in pockets across the state, many of the outages are occurring because of a run on fuel leading to a shortage of the product. The hardest hit areas are currently in western North Carolina and the Charlotte region. And let me also tell you some steps that we have already taken in preparation for today. As Colonial officials, who I want to thank very much, they've had a great line of communication with our emergency response team, and I know they're reacting as quick as possible. So as they continue to fix this damaged pipeline, we have taken steps in North Carolina to alleviate fuel disruptions and also protect customers from fuel gouging. On Thursday, I declared a state of emergency and signed executive orders to do the following. First of all, temporarily waive hours of service and other trucking restrictions of fuel vehicles traveling in and through the state. That is, we're trying to get as many trucks who are now delivering to North Carolina to get to North Carolina as quick as possible. So I've waived many of the restrictions for trucking to get them to our state as quick as possible. We have also, to protect customers, we have made sure that we are, to protect customers from excessive pricing at the fuel pumps during the shortage, we are working with the Attorney General's office to ensure that we are enforcing the price gouging laws. I do want to state that our Environmental Department is working to provide practical guidance because the law is rather vague to ensure that businesses understand how to comply with North Carolina price gouging laws. As a state, we have enacted short-term conservation measures until normal fuel flows are completely restored. Yesterday, I instructed all state agencies to consider options to limit fuel use, including curtailing non-essential travel for state employees. Additionally, I want to thank many counties who have already implemented fuel conservation plans. We have also encouraged the private sector to take similar measures to encourage employees, if they can, to telecommunicate where appropriate and minimize non-essential travel. We're also encouraging motorists to take similar measures to reduce their fuel when possible and resist the temptation to run to the gas station to top off their tanks. That causes more problems than anything, especially during the next 24 hours. Finally, I'm also calling on the EPA, the federal government, to temporarily waive vapor collection regulations during the transfer of fuel at our ports to help more efficiently fill tanker ships and trucks. This is a problem right now, and we've got a long line of tanker trucks at our ports at this point in time because of the very stringent vapor regulations, which we would like a waiver to temporarily stop that so we can get these trucks to the marketplace as quick as possible. In closing, I want to thank our emergency operations team. I want to thank those in the private sector, and I also want to thank the counties and the fuel suppliers who are working to replenish fuel, especially to first responders and emergency operation workers, and also to the general public. In the meantime, my executive order remains in effect to protect motorists from excessive gas prices and minimize any interruptions in fuel supply and travel throughout the state of North Carolina. Now, I do want to state, back in 2008, in fact, when I was mayor of Charlotte, we ran into a very similar situation. And one thing we've learned is that this is typically a short-term problem, and it'll remain a short-term problem if we follow these guidelines. We know we can all pull together as a state and get through this temporary disruption, and we'll look forward to returning to business as normal. With that, Mr. Sprayberry and I would be glad to answer questions related to this topic. Any questions? And if you could recognize yourself who you're with, I'd appreciate it. We have gotten hundreds of complaints of price gouging that are being referred to the Attorney General's office. We are seeing there's some confusion about the definition of price gouging and how general the guidelines are. In fact, we don't have facts on this, but we may have even had some gas stations turn down the gas for fear that they don't understand the regulation. And that's why we've got my environmental department is calling on the Attorney General to make sure we've got clear guidance on that. Our goal is to get the gas to the consumer as quick as possible while also protecting the consumer. And we want to make sure we accomplish both those goals. Well, the only thing we would recommend, as I'm recommending to state employees, I've basically canceled all non-essential travel because I want us to get through this next 24 to 48 hours until hopefully we return back to normal. When we initially set up this press conference, we did not have the good news from Colonial. So that is incredibly positive news where it looks like we'll be back to normal within the next 2 to 3 days. But we want to realize that we're only at one-third capacity. If everyone rushes to the gas station, which we saw in 2008, then we've just compounded our problem. But now I think as the consumer gets the news that the pipe is fixed, hopefully some of those temptations will calm down. We're sometimes our own worst enemy in responding to a crisis like this. In fact, we thought about doing a press conference yesterday, but in doing a press conference, sometime we actually encourage the temptation to fill up your gas tank when you don't need it, and that impacts the natural supply and demand that we typically have every day. But we thought this morning it was very important, not knowing that information that we had just in the last hour, to communicate to the public on where we were.
Jason Sujanku, Channel 9. How optimistic do you feel? Because this morning, I guess, when you woke up, it looked like you saw this problem, but then that note came out that looks like it could be resolved as early as tomorrow, and then take a couple days to kick in.
I'm pretty optimistic. We feel a lot better. We've had conference phone calls for the past 24 hours. Mike Sprayberry, who does a great job with his team during winter storms and tornadoes and hurricanes, you know, if this would have continued, we would have had some serious problems. But the official announcement from Colonial that they have fixed it gives reason to be much more calm I think that's a very positive message for the consumer. We were most concerned about our emergency response teams, especially in the far west, who were running out of gas. And it would have been a terrible situation if we had had accidents and other situations, emergencies, where ambulances and our highway patrol and fire trucks didn't have sufficient gas. That was our biggest concern during the next 24 to 48 hours. For the first responders that I have behind me. And I think this sends a positive message. especially to the consumer, not to take short-term action, which causes us more long-term harm.
Mark Garrison, WBT. This is one pipeline that brings nearly all the gas we use.
Yeah.
It was built in 1963, and it's, by all accounts, from Colonial Pipeline, a mess in some places. Are we likely to see this keep happening?
Well, the predictions would be most likely it will. It looks like it occurred in 2008 when there was a fire. We've had fires at some refineries. You know, the oil comes to the western part of our state from the Gulf Coast, either Texas or Louisiana. And those supply lines are very vulnerable if only one break occurs. We've asked in the past, when I was Mayor of Charlotte, this issue came up, are there any other options? But you're talking in the billions of dollars, and the question would be where the money comes from. We're always fortunate that in the eastern part of our state, we get the gas trucked in from the coast and the ports, so they are not as susceptible to a one-time break in Houston or in Louisiana. So the pipeline is not resilient to interruptions. And we wish there was a more resilient type of structure for our nation, as North Carolina is probably the state most impacted by this type of activity. And also Western Tennessee is also impacted. But I think when this news goes up out, especially in the Asheville, Boone area and further west, we are having some issues in Cherokee County late last night and early this morning, where there were some major fuel outages. In Raleigh, I think this morning things are returning to normal. In Raleigh, we saw some people rushing to the gas tank because they watched the news and they were taking care of themselves, and as opposed to looking at the bigger picture. But we anticipate things to return to normal pretty quickly, especially east of Charlotte, and then west of Charlotte. It's going to take several more days. And we're going to continue to try to get these trucks to the lines and to the gas stations as quick as possible. And that's why I'm going to continue to lift the restrictions. And we still need help down at our port regarding the EPA restriction, because we have a very long line of trucks wanting to get gas so they can take it to the marketplace. Now, that's a great question. I think part of the problem, and I might have Mike explain this a little bit, is how the marketplace works in the western part of the state on how they buy gas. And what's the term we use?
Spot market.
Spot market. We have more spot market buying along the pipeline than we do in the gas that is bought from ships coming from overseas. So, you know, it's a market condition that at times puts it at a disadvantage in the Triad and Charlotte, Nashville, Boone area. And I don't think we're going to change that market concept, because that market concept also provides cheaper gas for the marketplace when things are normal until we have a break in the line. So it's the spot market concept that is impacting us. I will say this, although the trucks, we are trying to get as quick as we can to the western part of the state that is impacted by this. And that's why on the eastern part of the state, if people start rushing to their tank, they're really doing it for no reason at all, because they're really getting the fuel they need at this point in time. The main disruption of the third is in the western. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
He's probably going to say yes, sir, regardless. Any other questions? Yes, sir. One more.
Let's circle back to what you said about the system. People are hearing that it's a fragile system, it could happen again. You may not want to think it's just a matter of waiting until the next one, you know, 8 years down the road, maybe sooner. Is there anything that we can do, anything we can do to be proactive to protect against something like this?
I'm not aware. We do not have a grid system like we have in the electric utility system, where you can all of a sudden go around and hook up to another transmission line. The gas system is pretty susceptible to breakage for a large area. The question would be who would pay for it, and then how would that cost be transferred to the consumer in the long run? But in the long run, there is a weakness in the infrastructure when there is a break in gas lines. Again, this is the second time I've seen it as a leader of mayor, as mayor of Charlotte, and now as governor of North Carolina. The good news is I'm pleased that the private sector stepped up very quickly to fix that. They've been working 24 hours around the clock, literally 300 or 400 people working to repair this line as quick as possible. So I don't think they've gotten a lot of sleep, and we need to thank those workers doing it on our behalf as they come from the private sector. I especially, again, we could have been in some very difficult situations had we not gotten that good news today. And I want to reiterate that that is very good news for the first responders and the consumers of North Carolina. And then hopefully, as the fuel supply gets back to normal, the prices will get back to normal too, which has an impact on our economy. We are actually spending money right now, about $50,000 a day.
Yes, sir.
About $50,000 a day that's coming out of our budget to speed up and get gas to the people that need it. And I'd like to cut that off as quick as possible too and not have to take that money out of our reserves. With that, again, I'd like to also thank the media for communicating this information. I encourage you to also do it in the right tone so we don't compound the problem that's now being fixed, if you understand what I'm saying. Thank you all very much. God bless each one of you. Thank you all very much.